So Niki is an associate professor in the Faculty of Geology and Geoenvironment, the University of Athens, and which is one of the biggest universities in Greece based in Athens. She has a degree in geology and postgraduate studies in geology and environment, geography and environment. She worked on her PhD on geomorphological and environmental study in Naxos Island, using remote sensing and GIS. And she has, I'm going a little bit quicker, she has participated in more than 60 research projects, 110 European meetings, and she has more than 200 publications in international Greek scientific journals. She has participated in more than 85 conferences. She has 17 books and many lectures and seminars in Greece and abroad. They also worked on patent, diploma of patent from the Industrial Property Organization. I don't even know. System of automatic flow production from the Rainless Network Overflow. Niki, you are going to explain us because in another patent, you have at least a patent. Bravo. She has an award from the State Scholarship Foundation, and she is also an underwater photographer. She's a diving geologist. Yes, and she has worked, okay, she has organized the educational seminars, a lot of field work, and also training activities. And she has organized more than 20 conferences and workshops. As you can see, and now she's assistant professor. She's also associate in the Laboratoire de Géographique Physique de CNRS à Paris. And she has a lot of fieldwork activities in Greece and abroad, for example, Paros, and here we're in Paros and in Greece in general, underwater. A sampling in the Lake of Altesi for recent fieldwork activities, tidal notches in the Cyclades, tidal notches is her specialty. We work in Italy in the fish tanks in Formia, in Alexandria in Egypt, and also in Corfu, Paros, and Attica. You can always see them, the work on the wave notches. Cave mapping in Samos Island and fieldwork in Iceland. So now I think you have a very good idea. Niki, would you like to present yourself or say something before the presentation starts?
Yes, I would like. Sorry. Good evening, everybody. I'm very glad to be here with you today. And thank you, Calliope, for this nice invitation. And any kind of lecture is an experience also for us who are giving the lecture. So it is a nice opportunity also for me to have a discussion with you in a subject related to sea level changes and sea level indicators during Holocene. So this is the subject of the lecture today. As Calliope mentioned, I have prepared this presentation in a format of a video because there are a lot of videos playing, and through the Skype, the voice and the image maybe wouldn't synchronize. So we will use this way, and we'll see how it works. Anyway, during the presentation, although it is a video playing behind, I would like to stop it anytime you feel that you would like to discuss something and have any questions or comments. And I will stop it anyway every time I will change a category of sea level indicators in order to discuss and to be sure that you have understood, you have no questions, and then we will go on. So, Calliope, from time to time, I will ask you to pose the
sure.
presentation. Okay?
No problem. So, okay.
Welcome to this lecture about Holocene sea level changes and sea level indicators. First of all, let's see which are the causes of recent sea level changes. Changes are due to tectonic effects, and also we have changes due to climatic effects. But we know that there is an acceleration of sea level during the last decades. What are the causes of this recent sea level rise? And I don't mean in local level, because in local level there are also tectonic influences. In global level, it's the thermal expansion of seawater that plays an important role to sea level rise due to the ocean warming and ocean mass increase, and also due to water addition from land ice melt and terrestrial water stores. This sea level rise acceleration causes many problems. Before we go with any project that will give a solution to such problems, we need to know the trend. But how can we estimate this trend? The answer is sea level indicators. The present-day sea level variations are usually measured by tide gauges or satellites, but for studying past sea levels, it is necessary to find marks left by past sea levels. And these indicators may be biological, sedimentological, archaeological for the last few thousand years, and geomorphological that could be either erosional or depositional. I will start with the biological sea level indicators that can be built up, constructional, or erosional, or a combination of both. But before we name a biological remain as biological sea level indicator, we should specify what kind of characteristics it should have. First of all, it needs to have the strongest possible relationship with the sea level, which means that its vertical zonation should be limited around sea level, or its upper limit should correspond to the sea level. Secondly, it should be able to resist erosion for a sufficient time period. And finally, it should be able to be dated accurately. Then, we have the sedimentological indicators. In this case, we should have in mind that sea level fluctuations, climate changes, and human interventions are recorded in the sediments of the coastal marshes and wetlands. Coastal marshes are particularly sensitive in local paleoenvironmental changes, and they are a powerful tool for the study of changes that have occurred during the last thousand years in the coastal zone. How to do that? We have to sample the sediments of coastal marshes and wetlands, and this usually takes place with the use of a drilling machine. There are of course many different types, and the choice is made based on the research, the study area, the material, the depth of sampling, etc. During the drilling process, contamination of the sample should be avoided, and it is important to keep notes and organize systematically the extracted information and samples. Okay, before we go on, I would like to ask you if everything is clear about, first of all, about biological indicators. I have made a list of the characteristics that a biological indicator should have. Is it all clear for you? Okay, then I would like to, if you do not have any questions about biological indicators, I would like to post one. And the question is this: why I mentioned that in order a biological indicator, a biological characteristic to be a biological sea level indicator, why I'm saying that we need its upper limit to correspond to the sea level if the vertical zonation is not limited around the sea level. Why I'm saying that?
Okay, can you repeat the question?
Yes. Okay. There is a question in one of my slides. The question is this: which should be the characteristics of a biological sea level indicator? And I'm answering this saying that it needs to have the strongest possible relationship with the sea level, which means that its vertical zonation should be limited around sea level, or its upper limit should correspond to the sea level. I would like somebody from the room to explain the second case, the upper limit to correspond to the sea level. Why the upper limit should correspond to the sea level? Why?
Est-ce que vous comprenez la question en anglais? À peu près. Est-ce que quelqu'un peut répondre avant tout? Est-ce que vous avez compris la question? C'est la première. Et si vous avez compris la question, vous pouvez répondre ou pas? Vous connaissez la réponse ou pas? C'est parce que vous ne connaissez pas la réponse ou parce que vous n'avez pas compris la question? Ah, ok, non, mais sinon je peux traduire. Yeah. Hey, Niki, would you like to help us?
Yes. Could you take the video a little bit?
Of course.
Before.
Yes. I'm going to go a little bit back. Here.
Back.
Here. Yes.
Here. Please leave this there. So, I write here that a biological sea level indicator needs to have a strong relationship with sea level. And the first bullet says either its vertical zonation should be limited around sea level or its upper limit should correspond to the sea level. I would like somebody to explain the last one. Why its upper limit should correspond to the sea level? Why?
It's not very difficult.
No, it is not.
Maybe you answer for us and you explain to us.
Okay. If a biological characteristic, for example, we find some cells, and we know that this little animal was when it was alive, its home was around the sea level, then it is really clear. We found it in the rock, and we understand that the position where we found it, it was the sea level. But if this animal was living in a wider range, not exactly at the sea level, for example, from minus 10 up to plus 10 meters above sea level, then when we find this animal in the field, it is not really clear if where the sea level used to be. So if we find its upper limit and we know that this animal was living from minus 10 up to zero, up to sea level, and we find the upper limit, then we understand that this upper limit used to be the former sea level. So what I want you to have in mind is that we do not really need a biological indicator that lives exactly at the sea level, because if this is the case, it's only few biological characteristics, and we may find none of them in the field. We may use additional biological characteristics from those that they were not living exactly at the sea level, but in a wide range, and we may use, when we find in the field, the whole series. For example, we may find 1 meter in a rock with the same biological characteristics. Then we may use the upper limit of this series, and we may say, okay, this upper limit used to be the sea level, the former sea level.
Did you understand? Do you want me to say it also in French? Or design it? Do you want a small sketch? Is it okay? Yes, you're fine? Okay, thank you very much, Niki. I think that we got it.
Okay.
Would you like me to continue from here or move a little bit on?
I would like also to ask the colleagues in the room, when they would go for a sedimentological indicators.
Okay.
In which kind of environment they would go for such a case?
Where would you search for sedimentological indicators? Where would you go to find a sedimentological indicator? This is the question. What does she see?
Yeah. In the coast and in the lagoonal environments?
Tiffany says in the coast and the lagoonal environments, of course. Yes.
Great. It is clear, I think it is clear that the sedimentological indicators is a difficult task, because you have to do all this work with drillings and then opening the cores, and then foraminifera and ostracogent. It is a huge procedure, and but in any case, we go for that. Why do you think, if we are in a lagoonal environment, we should choose to collect sea level indicators through this this method, through drillings, for example? Why would you do that?
Because you can see the evolution of the coastlines if the sea was
fluctuating.
Yes, fluctuating.
Perfect. Okay. Partly, this is the answer. The one part of the answer that is missing is that when we go in the field, we do not have any kind of indicators. Maybe we have one. If we are lucky, we may find more than one indicator. So sometimes you have no additional option, so you have to go for sedimentological indicators, for example, in a lagoonal environment. Secondly, Tiffany's answer was really great, because sedimentological indicators, they give the information about the sea level fluctuations, but also they give more and more information about the type of the environment, how it was changing. It is not only a case of the geographical evolution, but also the environmental evolution that other indicators do not clearly show this information.
Okay.
So, yes, let's go.
Okay.
The procedure is not easy during the sampling, but then there is also a long procedure in the lab. The paleogeography of the region, but also the relative sea level changes, may be unfolded through this method using also the datable material which is possibly found at a certain depth of the stratigraphic column. But apart from biomarkers that can be found in cores and used for dating, we may use surge from human constructions in order to date the specific level of the stratigraphic column. Going to the archaeological sea level indicators, an obvious evidence of minimum relative sea level rise provided by submerged structures that must have their foundations on dry land, for example, houses, tombs, mosaic floors, passageways, storage tanks, tells, middens. Frequent archaeological examples refer to structures that may have been partly in the sea and may provide reliable sea level indicators. Such constructions can be breakwaters, docks, jetties, channels, drains, salt pans, coastal quarries, or finally installations for fishing or fish farming. Great. Meanwhile, we could establish a discussion.
Yes, please.
And we could say that, okay, before going to archaeological indicators, we had the sedimentological indicators, and we discussed about drillings. This is the way we extract the samples for sedimentological indicators. We sample sediments from coastal marshes and wetlands, and we use drilling machines. These drilling machines could be either big vesicles, or it could be small equipment like the one that you saw in my slides. And then what we have to do, we have to organize very well the samples in the field, otherwise we will be lost in the lab afterwards. So we organize everything in the tubes, we write very clearly the samples we have taken, and then we are going back to the lab. In the lab we have to open the tubes, so that's why you saw some tubes open in my slides, and you may find in the tubes some material for dating. It could be cells. It could be, but it could be also man-made characteristics, search and things like that. So in this case, we are talking about sedimentological indicators, but in fact, it is a combination, because in fact, in any kind of research, what we are doing is combining information and combining sciences and things like that. So it is in this method we have also a combination of indicators. It is a sedimentological indicator because we have it in a sedimentological column, in a stratigraphic column, but also we use biological indicator found inside the stratigraphy, or archaeological indicators, if we find something, an archaeological evidence inside also in the stratigraphic column. Then we have the archaeological indicators. It was part the presentation that you have already seen. Some of these archaeological sea level indicators give an obvious evidence of a minimum relative sea level, because there are some structures that it is really clear that they were not constructed in the sea. So we know that the sea was not there. For example, we may find houses inside the sea, tombs, mosaic floors, or tells, middens, etc. So we have a minimum relative sea level rise information. But what we really need is indicators showing not that we had a sea level rise, but with an unknown amount of rise, we need to know the exact information how much sea level was rising.
Going to that, fish traps and turtle pens have been reported from many cultures, for example the Caribbean, India, Australia, and from Romans for the Mediterranean Sea. What are the advantages? I think it is obvious. We don't have to date. We already know the date. For example, Roman fish tanks came into fashion for each Romans the 1st century BC and until the 1st century AD. When certain elements are well preserved and the functioning of the structure is well understood, fish tank remains allow to estimate the sea level position of about 2,000 years ago with an excellent accuracy. Here, there is a short video from a fish tank in Alexandria, Egypt. It's a very well preserved fish tank of the Roman period. You may notice that there is a breakwater in order to prevent the fish tank from storms and waves. There are several tanks separated from each other, and there are also channels and places for shadows for the fish. Fish need shadow to have some rest, and you may also see how the tanks were separated the one to the other. In fact, here we have one big tank with several small tanks either for different kind of fishes or for different kind of fish farming. There are many morphological characteristics in a fish tank that may be used as sea level indicators, such as the top of the closing gauge, which is called cataracte for the Roman fish tanks. Each different morphological characteristic has a different accuracy as sea level indicator, but this is a long discussion. Here you may have an example of such a closure. It is exceptionally rare to find these elements due to their original location in the wave breaking zone. You may notice here the holes that are big enough for fresh water to enter to the fish tank and renew the water inside the installation, but not big enough for fish to leave the tank. Channels were used to connect the tank with the open sea to ensure water renewal. Channel direction ranges according to the individual morphological and hydrodynamic coastal characteristics of the area, trying to take advantage of wave power in order to let fresh water pass into a fish pod. Columella has suggested that channels were positioned on every side of the fish tank, low on the wall of the enclosure, so that the water forced through these openings would originate from the cooler depths of the sea. Smaller channels would distribute the water and further ensure adequate circulation inside the fish tank. Some channels were used for bringing fresh water from the inland to the fish tank. These channels were used by fish during their seasonal migrations and they were perfect spots to catch fish. The outer part of the fish tank towards the open sea should have been blocked by gates in order to stop the fish migration towards the open sea. For that reason, Slice gates were used, operating along sliding grooves cut into stones. Channels open to the sea had to supply water at least during the high tide cycle. The top of the channels should have remained immersed during the highest tides. In fact, it is assumed that the top of the channels should have been at 40 cm above former mean sea level in order to allow the fish tank keepers to reach the entrance of the outer channels during storms. Estimates of lower limits of past sea level are based on the premise that at least 10 cm of high tide water must have passed over the bottom of the supplying channel at the basin entrance in order to have viable conditions maintained inside the tank. Before we move to geomorphological indicators, we may notice at this point that the advantage of the archaeological sea level indicators is that we already know the date. But there are many difficulties, such as the understanding of the functionality of each characteristic of the installation, and to know the exact position related to the former sea level in order to extract the sea level fluctuation during that time period. Going to the geomorphological indicators, we have two different types, the erosional and the depositional.
Small break in order to discuss. Before we start discussing and raise your the questions that you may have, I would like to make it strong, to point it in a strong way that we do like archaeological indicators because we already know the date. And this is really important because there are so many different sea level indicators. We may have a discussion later about also geomorphological sea level indicators that give us an information of what has happened, what kind of sea level fluctuations we had in a wide format, how this fluctuation took place. It was, for example, co-seismic, it was gradual, but sometimes it's really difficult to date because it is often not to have dating material. In archaeological sea level indicators, we have the date, but it is really important to understand how this archaeological formation was constructed related to the sea level. What was the connection between the construction and the former sea level? This is why it is really important the multidisciplinarity in this kind of research, to have different kind of researchers from different disciplines: archaeologists, geologists, geomorphologists, geographers, researchers working with geodesy, and so on, because each of them may provide an information that if we put everything together, then we may have a result. Maybe then we may have an answer of what happened and how. And this is what we have tried to do through McAGENDA, that it was a project with multidisciplinarity, and we did the same in the training schools. For those that you already participated in one of them, you know it very well. So before we go on with the geomorphological sea level indicators, I would like to hear your comments or maybe questions of what we have discussed so far.
Any questions or comments?
Well, we have different levels of knowledge here. We have the
you know, the students that just started the master, and some of them that they are in the second year, and some of them that they were in your training school. Mm-hmm. So I ask that. But if you have any kind of questions or
okay, don't be shy. There is no silly question. it is not for sure that I will be able to answer. So please raise your question. It is just a discussion.
Yeah. And if you want, si vous voulez aller en français, si c'est possible.
For example, we have mentioned so many different archaeological evidence, but I have spent much more time on fish tanks, and especially on Roman fish tanks. Why did I do that? Why fish tanks are important for research in sea level fluctuations during late Holocene.
Yeah, as an archaeologist, you could be able to answer that. Why fish tanks? Why, if you have to choose between different archaeological indicators, why would you choose fish tanks, as she did?
Water from certain fishes, so need to be the nearest as possible at the sea level.
Exactly. I don't know if you hear the answer, but it was exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Very, very well. And then, if you would like to use another kind of archaeological sea level indicator, not only fish tank, what would be your second choice? Let's say.
Breakwaters. We have ships and breakwaters.
Okay.
Sorry, there is a propaganda here or something going on.
Okay, great, great, very nice. If you do not have any questions about what we have said so far, we may go on geomorphological sea level indicators.
Mm-hmm.
As you may notice, we have two different categories, the erosional and depositional geomorphological indicators. We may discuss first the one part, and then we go to the other.
Okay.
I will start from the depositional geomorphological sea level indicators and especially beach rocks. Beach rocks consist of clastic coastal deposits cemented by aragonite or high magnesium calcite near the intertidal zone in the interface of freshwater and seawater. We may have either emerged or submerged beach rocks that may be used as sea level indicators. And since the lithification takes place at the coastline, beach rocks have been used as indicators in quaternary sea level and neotectonic studies. Each sea level indicator has advantages and disadvantages. There is no perfect sea level indicator. If in our case study we have more than one sea level indicators, it will be great because we may combine, we may correlate the data we extracted from them, and we may use the advantages of each one. There are several problems in the use of beach rocks as sea level indicators. For example, it is difficult to determine the upper level of beach rock cementation, which may correspond to the mean high water springs. However, in regions with high tidal range, this limit may be quite large. An additional problem may arise from any change in the tidal range, originating from local changes. Here you may notice a thin section of beach rock under polarized microscope, where you may notice the cement around the grains. The cementation of the lower level of an exposed beach rock may have occurred at an earlier stage during a rising sea level, or more recently in a falling sea level, or during any variation. Consequently, Only the upper limit of beach rock constitutes an accurate indicator of past tidal level. The accurate dating of beach rocks is a very difficult task, even though biogenic materials such as shells or corals can be easily dated by radiocarbon. The age acquired, however, corresponds to the time of death of the organism. After death, the organism was transported from its in situ position, was deposited on a beach, and later was cemented into the beach rock. Although in many cases it is possible that this sequence takes place in a few years, it is likely that the time difference from the death of the organism to the cementation of the beach rock will reach hundreds or thousands of years. For this reason, the age acquired by dating an organism may be regarded as the maximum for the cementation of beach rock. A minimum age for the process is only possible by dating the cement. However, several difficulties arise in extracting enough cement, especially in the case of submerged beach rocks. Furthermore, it is possible that after exposure, any passing water may have caused carbonate exchange, resulting in continuous renewal of the apparent cementing age. Optically stimulated luminescence methods are also used for dating beach rocks, but this method gives the time since the last exposure of mineral grains to sunlight. We have erosional sea level indicators, and the most important are the tidal notches. Do you have any questions?
I have one, Niki.
Yes.
So, I know there is a big discussion between geologists about the credibility of using beach rock as a sea level indicator and generally and dating and everything. What is your opinion? I mean, how credible it is, how much do you use it, and what are the, you know, the parameters for using it as a geologist, and how can we use it as an archaeologist?
An excellent discussion you are opening, Calliope. Yes, in fact, there is a big discussion about this, and the most important problem is the accurate dating of beach rocks. Because, okay, you may find biogenic materials, but what are you dating when you date a biogenic material inside the beach rock? And then there are different other ways to date the beach rocks, but each of them has its own problems. In fact, what I do in my research, and I would suggest it to the young researchers, is not to use only one sea level indicator. I do not use only beach rocks or only tidal notches or only archaeological indicators or only sedimentological indicators. I'm trying to combine the information and the knowledge we get from each of them. So, of course, sometimes it is really difficult because it is not easy to have more than one sea level indicator in the same area. But you may go not only to your case study area, but further away to the area you are researching to understand what is going on, to understand the geology of the area. For example, we are dating submerged beach rocks in central Cyclades, and we were getting very strange dates from the deepest series of beach rocks. The deepest series, for example, we had beach rocks at minus 1 meter, minus 3 meters, minus 5 meters, and the beach rocks at minus 5 meters were giving dates much younger than the beach rocks at minus 1 meter. In cases like that, you have to be ready
to understand what is going on and to understand the geology of the area, because in order to be possible to have something like that and to have beach rocks in minus 5 meters with a younger date than the beach rocks in minus 1 meter, it means that the geology of the area should have the ups and downs. And so it is important to understand, first of all, the geology of the area. Is it possible to have something like that? Do you have other kind of indicators, not only sea level indicators, other kind of indicators in the area supporting this tectonically ups and down in the area? If not, then you may, then you should start thinking of the methodology, if it is good or not. And we are researchers, and we have to be able to have a debate with our own selves. We do not accept something like that because OSL gave us a date like that. So what I am doing is, first of all, I'm trying to understand the geology and the tectonics of the area I'm working, and then I'm using sea level indicators, but not only one, if possible. If not possible, I'm really, if I have to use only one sea level indicator, I'm very critical with what I'm finding and with my own self, myself. So, this is.
And what about the dating? Do you think that we have found an hyperic methodology or a graded methodology of dating these rocks?
I am using OSL for dating beach rocks. But I'm also very cautious with the results, because sometimes when beach rocks are very old or are very deep, maybe you have renewal because of the water that goes again and again in the cement of the beach rock. Maybe you have a renewal, and maybe this is the reason that sometimes we get crazy dates. So personally, I use OSL. It is not easy, because you have to extract big pieces of beach rocks, and when you are underwater, it is really, really difficult. And secondly, there are a type of cement in a beach rock, a type of beach rock that cannot, that also OSL is not working. For example, if the beach rock is very coarse, it is very difficult to date it through OSL, at least up to now.
You know what OSL is, huh? Optical
illusions.
It's a method. Can you tell us
the
words, what is OSL, because you said
to take for granted? Yes. Okay. First of all, let's say that we have different types of dating in a beach rock. The most common one, and the one that most researchers were using in the past was radiocarbon. For example, you were finding a cell inside the beach rock, so you were dating the cell. But as I mentioned before, the cell, the animal could die anytime, and the cell could be in the beach for a long duration, maybe some years, or but it could be also many decades. And when you date this cell, you date in fact the date that the animal died. So this is the one way to date beach rock. The other way is to date the cement. Okay, you may do that, but with this fact we have difficulties because it is sometimes very difficult to extract enough cement. There is a nice slide in my presentation showing a thin section of the beach rock. Kalliope, if you could show it right now, it would be great, because you may see how thin sometimes the cement is around the cells of the sand.
You mean the photo from the microscope?
Yes, this one.
Yeah, that was a very good one. Just give me a second. Here.
Okay, great. Okay, you may pause it right now, and you may see the cement is this thing, circles around, yes, that's right, around the pebbles or around the grains of the sand. So you can understand that it is really difficult to extract enough cement, especially in the case of the submerged beach rocks. But even if you do that, as I mentioned before, any passing water through the beach rock may have caused carbonate exchange in a continuous renewal of the water, so the cementing age will appear different than the real one. And then we have the OSL method, which is the optically stimulated luminescence. In fact, we date the time that a grain, the last time that the grain saw the sunlight. It's the last time that a grain was exposed to sunlight. So in order to do that, we have to take a sample in a way that the sample should not see any light. So you could do it late in the night, or you could do it in a, you could take a big piece of a sample, and you may use in the method the inner part of the sample. This is the same way we are dating sand dunes, and normally we sampling during the night. For beach rocks, and especially submerged beach rocks, you can take a big sample, and you may use for dating the inner part of it. As I mentioned before, this method gives the last time of the grain's exposure to the sunlight, which means that maybe this sand was covered by something else and then it was cemented. So we do not really have the exact date that the beach rock was forming, because the forming of the beach rock is the time that a beach is cemented. It becomes hard, like a cement. That's why we said before that there is no perfect method. We try to use more than one and then compare the results. For sure, all these methods are very expensive. And sometimes, although we have the material in the field that could be used for several different methods, we cannot afford to do that. So my opinion is to use different methods and compare, and different sea level indicators and compare. And before you do any of this, you have to understand the geology and the tectonics of the area. Otherwise, you are lost. You may say, whatever.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, great. Should we go on with wait, we were in which minute?
I have written tidal notches as morphotectonic indicator. This is because tidal notches give more information than the magnitude of sea level change. Let's see what are the tidal notches and how we may use them as sea level indicators. In tectonically active coastal areas, sudden relative sea level changes are taking place before, during, and after earthquake events. Only a few types of sea level indicators may help in distinguishing the effects of an instantaneous movement from factors operating for decades to centuries. Notches can do that based on their shape and their height related to the local tidal range. Dating relict fossil shorelines is often difficult, especially when their position is below modern sea level and thus has been subjected to bioerosion by organisms that live in or below the intertidal zone, and they produce bioerosion, so we cannot find dating material. There are many different types of notches, but let's see first what notches are. Notches are coastal recesses extending along marine cliffs. They develop because of higher lowering rates in the intertidal zone rather than in the supratidal or subtidal zone. Notches can be divided into different types according to their origin and shape. They include structural notches, lithological notches, abrasion, and many different kinds of littoral notches. Structural notches are autostratigraphical or tectonic discontinuities, and they are not used as sea level indicators. They are formed in coastal cliffs consisting of horizontal or slightly inclined layers, when differential erosion affects the layers with different resistance and produces notch-like formations. Lithological notches are owed to differential erosion between layers of different resistance. They are a kind of structural notches, and as such, they are not used as sea level indicators. Abrasion notches are formed due to mechanical abrasion of sand and cobbles moving constantly in the surf zone. Their elevation can vary and they can develop between the subtidal zone and the high tide level. Their elevation is usually unrelated to the local tidal range, so they are not used as sea level indicators. Finally, we have different kinds of littoral notches. Among mid-littoral notches, the best sea level indicators are tidal notches that are known to undercut cliffs of carbonate rock formations, especially in microtidal marine areas. Let's see how this type of notches is developed. Bioerosion by endolithic organisms and surface feeders grazing upon epi and endolithic algae are generally acknowledged to play an important role in tidal notch development. In the mid-littoral zone, parallel vegetational belts are more developed. Eroding cyanobacteria, petalaceous gastropods and chitons are more abundant. They all contribute by eating the vegetational belts to the erosion of the underlying rock and enable the development of a reclined U-shaped or V-shaped intertidal notch. The erosion rate is generally highest near mean sea level and decreases gradually towards the upper and lower limits of the intertidal range. Accordingly, in places sheltered from continuous wave action, if mean sea level remains stable, notch profiles will be typically reclined U-shaped or V-shaped with a vertex located near mean sea level. The rate of maximum undercutting near mean sea level varies with the rock type and the local climate. It has been roughly estimated by Laborel et al. In 1999 of the order of 1 mm per year. However, this is only a first order value, while lower rates are generally observed in hard limestones, especially in non-tropical areas. There is a vast bibliography about the rates of bioerosion, and in some places measurements have taken place in order to find out the rate of this erosion. For each area, there are slight changes based on the environmental characteristics. Where should we expect tidal notches? Carbonate rocks are generally favorable to the development and preservation of tidal notches, while gneisses, schists, amphibolites, terrestrial deposits and volcanic rocks are less affected by erosion. The most favorable conditions for a tidal notch formation occur where the cliff is vertical, while the slope of the cliff or irregularities in the rock surface may retard or even prevent the development of a clear notch profile. Here, you may see a simple sketch of how a notch is forming. The units are arbitrary, the erosion is depicted with a white bar and the build-up with a red bar. We shall have a stable sea level for 5 slides and then we will have a rapid tectonic movement. Okay, let's see what will happen. We have a stable sea level. And so, there is enough time for all these organisms to erode the rock. The rock is not only eroded by the organism, but this is the main factor in tidal notches. A rapid uplift took place. So, what happened? A notch was formed because the sea level was stable. Now, this notch is uplifted up to here, and at the new sea level, a new tidal notch will form. In case of a rapid subsidence, the tidal notch will be submerged, and in the new sea level, a new tidal notch will form again if the sea level is stable once again. What's the difference between these two situations? In the first one, we have uplift, now we have subsidence. In the case of subsidence, the constructive relict structures are soon subjected to marine bioerosion and it is very difficult to find material to date. Tidal notches is an excellent sea level indicator, not only because it depicts the difference between the former sea level related to the nowadays sea level, but also it gives information about the duration the sea level remains stable, and also it gives information about the way this change took place, for example, gradual or co-seismic. Here you may see an example from Japan. You may see the former sea level from an uplifted tidal notch related to the nowadays sea level. Let's have another example. It is a simple analog model between sea level rise and erosion. The units are again arbitrary for both sea level and erosion. We shall have steady rise, A, for some slides. You may notice that sea level is rising, and because it is rising, there is no enough time for the notch to produce. As we mentioned before, we need about 1 mm per year, so if the rate of sea level rise is rapid, then there is no enough time for a notch to develop. Now, I will decrease the rate of sea level rise to the half. We still have sea level rise, a slower one though. So again, there was not enough time for a notch to be formed. And now, the sea level will rise again with a rate A. Nothing is happening because time was not enough for a notch to be formed. Now the sea level will be steady and let's see what will happen. A notch has been formed. And let's see what will happen if we have now a sea level rise with AA rate. This is what happened. The notch is now submerged. Now the sea level will rise again, but with a smaller rate reduced to A. So, no notch is forming. And the former notch is drawing more and more. And now, sea level rise will be reduced even more. But still no notch is formed, and now we should have a stable sea level for a while. And because sea level was stable, a new notch was developed. So this is the procedure that takes place in order a notch to be formed. The profile of a tidal notch is an excellent sea level indicator and provides information on the duration in which mean sea level remained at the level of the notch vertex, and if the notch is emerged or submerged, it gives also information on the speed, slow or even sudden, of its emergence or submergence. Notch profiles can be useful to identify long-term or even sudden relative sea level variations. Notch profiles can be modified by sufficiently long enduring changes in the relative sea level, thus testifying of pre-seismic or post-seismic gradual tectonic trends. Here you may notice different tidal notch profiles resulting from slow or rapid sea level changes in sheltered sites. They have been listed from various case studies resulting from uplift in your left or subsidence in your right. You may also watch a video in my YouTube channel showing the different notch profiles and how we may extract information from them about the way the sea level was fluctuating. If a movement of the relative sea level occurs, the notch profile will be modified. In the case of a rapid, for example, co-seismic emergence greater than the tidal range, the notch completely emerged will be preserved from further marine bioerosion, while a new notch will develop in the new lower intertidal zone. On the other hand, in the case of rapid submergence greater than the tidal range, the whole notch will be submerged. It will not be completely preserved from further bioerosion, as in the case of emergence, and its profile will be uniformly deepened by the rate of bioerosion that predominates in the infralittoral zone, while a new tidal notch will develop in the intertidal range. However, the infralittoral bioerosion rate is generally estimated to be one order of magnitude less than the intertidal one. If the rapid submergence is less than the tidal range, the height of the notch will increase with further deepening in the new intertidal zone, while the part of the notch below the low tide level will continue to be deepened at a much slower rate, and the notch profile will be marked by an undulation at the level of the roof of the former notch. Finally, in the case of gradual emergence or submergence, the height of the notch will gradually increase. The lower part of its profile will become higher than the upper part, and no marked undulation will appear in the profile. In the case of gradual relative sea level rise, calculations show that the inward depth of the tidal notch remains very limited, while its height tends to increase. Here is the video that I propose to watch through my YouTube channel.
Shall we make a pause here? Mm-hmm. Okay, before we go on, maybe you have some questions.
Did you understand all about wave notches, how they are forming and their importance, and how they can be used as relative sea level indicators? Yes.
I think that was a very clear part. You have graphically presented, Niki, I think it's even for non-specialists is very easy to follow.
Okay, I'm glad.
Yes, that's good.
I would like to make clear that although we are discussing about geomorphological sea level indicators, you may notice that it is the categories in the research are not black and white. It is more gray. So we are talking about geomorphological indicators, but we are using also biological indicators. How? We may understand the notch. First of all, you notice that we have many different types of notches. So what researchers have to do is to understand what kind of notch they have in the field. We may use only tidal notches because this is related to sea level, to former sea level, and then in order to date the tidal notch, we need the biological indicator. Otherwise, we have again a very important information of what has happened, because notches may give information about the way that this fluctuation took place. If you find, for example, an archaeological construction submerged, the only thing you know is that the sea level was rising. You had sea level rise. If you find a beach rock submerged, you know the same, that you had sea level rise. But if you find a tidal notch submerged, you may understand how the sea level rise took place. If it was gradual, or abrupt. This is important anyway, no matter if you do not have the date, because you may date with other kind of sea level indicators. For example, you may understand through the tidal notches how these sea level fluctuations took place, and you may use sedimentological indicators for drillings, from drillings in a nearby lagoon, in order to date somehow the tidal notches you found. So that's why I said that the categories are not clear. We have different kind of indicators. I have categorized them somehow, but the categories are more gray than black and white, and it is important to use more than one sea level indicator. Then, after this point, I have a video that you may also watch it anytime you wish, if you follow my YouTube channel, because I have noted that it is the time is flying.
Yes.
So it is not necessary to watch it right now. You may watch it through my YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. And this video explains the different types of notches. For example, you had two slides with the different shapes of notches. And I have named it notch type A, notch type B, etc. So in this video, you may see these different types of notches in the field, how a researcher can see it in the field, how you may recognize it, and the interpretation, how these notches was produced, why the shape is like that. And if you really understand this, then when you go in the field and you see a type like that, you may figure out what happened to the area. For example, we had two events. One, it was co-seismic, and the other one, it was a gradual sea level rise, which is really important. And after that, you may use different types of indicators to date or to correlate or to verify, etc. So, my presentation ends here. I will be glad to discuss either now if you have questions or later, because some questions may come to your mind later on. And you may contact me in the... Calliope, if you go this video to the end, to the very end, it is the last slide of my presentation. And... And in this last slide, you may see my web page, and through that you may contact me if you have any questions about the discussion about this lecture we had today that may come to your mind later on. Sometimes. Questions needs time.
Yes, of course. Okay, I'm going to find the details and I'm going to share it with the students. Do you have any general question before we pass to the presentation of Stefano Furlani? Okay, Niki, thank you very much already. Thank you.
Thank you. It was my pleasure. And before we end, I would like to say, maybe Calliope, you can also pass this information to your students, that we have a conference we are co-organizing. This conference is also related to sea level changes and sea level indicators and geoarchaeology and archaeology and sea level fluctuations. And if any of your students would like to join, there is a small fund that they may use. So please, Calliope, pass them the information.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see you. Goodbye.
Yes, bye. Bye, Niki. Bye.